50% of emergency departments in Lebanon, you know, have some degree of knowledge of what their plan is. Many people do the plan in a piece of paper or a document that's in a policy in a drawer of someone, but that doesn't mean that everybody knows what it is. And even if the head of the department may know what it is, the head of the department may be in Wasim lecturing. So something else may be happening over there, and everybody should know their role and their duties to really activate. Is it, do you have a plan? Is it an actual plan? Will it work? Has it been tested to match your resource and reality? Not to really be just principles you advocate for that no one knows about. And do all stakeholders know about it? Have you trained and included, you know, housekeeping and registration and security and pharmacy, central supplies? Are they all aware of what their duties are in the case of an activation? So when do you activate a plan? Everyone with a bit of testosterone thinks that they should be. Fortunately, my department is led by my colleague, Dr. Professor Evelyn Hitti. Evelyn doesn't have testosterone, so really she really thought very carefully about this and was able to develop a system which we believe is essential. We alert the hospital director, but mobilizing a whole hospital in should be done by the hospital director, not by you. In 2012, there was a Starko bombing which caused almost 40 casualties, about 5 dead, the rest were wounded. We were the closest hospital. They brought them all to us as usual because they were not, that's where their people tend to go. And well, that's not ideal, but that's where they tended to go. They had not learned yet to distribute them more properly through a proper dispatch. But patients don't know. They just rush to the closest place. So when we were struck, we realized that if we left the actual activation to the hospital director themselves alone, it may take half an hour to activate. And that half an hour is brutal, because the key element in preparing for the mass casualty second wave of patients, not the first few who tell you there is a problem, the key element is to have these 15 minutes are unforgiving. That's the time when you get ready, set things up, and call people in. You empty the department within this time. So what we realize is that it is essential for the department to retain the capacity to alert the institution for the put people on alert. So we have a tiered response. First we go on alert, and two we go on activation. The second thing we decided, because we do realize that you have to estimate your capacity, your search capacity, the time of the day. Can you, what can you handle? What is the exact number you're predicting of people to come? So you have to assess that before you go to the next step, and the next step is a level 2, not a level 1 activation. A level 2 activation is different than a level 1. Level 1, you activate everybody with the plan. But the level 2 is you activate only select services, or at least the people on call that you need to call in. You don't activate the dermatology consult on call, but you activate the trauma surgeons, you activate the general surgery department, you activate your intensive care support, the people on call, not everybody, but a limited response of activation. So to properly decide, you need a proper assessment of your ED current capacity and search capacity at that particular time. So the ED attending on duty in charge is the person who makes that assessment. I can't make it from here. They have to be on site. And then you have to secure early and properly, accurate information suggesting more victims are expected. And who is the best source for information? The best source of information is not the media, is not hospital security, is not the police, nor the hospital leadership. They themselves don't know. The media will take half an hour at least to get down there and figure out what's going on. So how do you know? So you can activate early. You will know from the first patients that will walk through your door. because they will, from the scene of the incident, these people, whoever brought them in a taxi cab, in a car, by family, or whether they drove themselves just with their walking wounded to your department, they will provide you the information, and that's the most accurate, relatively, source of early information to what's going on out there and whether you should predict that more victims are expected. Defining your capacity threshold, as I mentioned, should be defined by your own institution depending on your size. You can't, what is your capacity? What is the range of patients you can handle? We have more than 150 institutions in Lebanon. They're not all tertiary care centers. So you have to think in that sense. So using tiered activation, the level one, level two, like I mentioned, using an alert, and remembering that there is a general rule, which is the upside down triage, which I'll mention in the next lesson. But overall, if you want to assume, well, I'll go now here. No. Overall, you have to assume that you're going to get a first wave of walking wounded, and then a second wave. It's like a tsunami. You get a small wave, and then a bigger wave. The bigger wave is when the first responders have gotten down there and they're starting to bring to you the sicker patients that cannot transport themselves. So you see the first wave, always predict 20 minutes up to an hour after, you're going to start getting a double the number of the first wave you've received. It's almost kind of, I mean, I'm approximating, but if I get 20 patients that are walking wounded, I can comfortably assume that by the end of the second hour, I'll have 60 patients in my department. Of course, I'm referring here to single incident like car bomb and blasts. So when one thing happens and you have a lot of mass casualty, a single incident of blast, which is what we're used to in Lebanon, that's what we get. Now, of course, you can tell me, would that apply when you have an air raid or a structural collapse? No. People will take time to be extricated. You'll still have your first wave, but you'll have more severely injured people and patients will be delayed because they will need to be extricated, and that will make them dwindle over the few hours that come after. There is an assumption we always make that put them in the green, and then you know you come to the green at the end, that you're going to have additional resources. Well, unfortunately, this doesn't apply everywhere, because many places do not have additional resources. They may not have the supplies. They may not have enough. I mean, I own a medical center outside Beirut on the road to South. I have 10 chest tubes, 20 ET tubes, maybe less, probably expired. How able am I to really support a mass casualty incident? So resources may be outstripped, so you have to think about the duration and think of sustainability issues. Therefore, it may be advisable when you receive the greens and to make them wait, not to give them any attention. Triage them out, put them in the green zone, or instruct them to head somewhere else. To head to somewhere further away than the emergency department. If they're green, they don't need to be taken care of in your department if you're the closest to the close to the vicinity of the incident. I beg, impose, educate everybody not to call the emergency department. This is not the time, everybody should know, this is not the time to call the head of the department, hello, do you need me? Should I come down? Look, I'm in outside an hour away. Should I really come? Is it bad? How is it like? This is not the time. Already when you have a bomb blast, most phone lines will be overwhelmed and you will have an interruption of communication. Do not burden the ED. Follow the plan. Go to where you need to go when you're supposed to be mobilized. Do not strain what's already strained and distract us. Follow or don't come. Pre-identify mobilization sites where they go. Hospital employees should not come to the hospital, to the ED. They should go to the cafeteria or to the patio away from the ED, and that's where they gather. And the leadership of the disaster committee, the chief of staff, the nursing director, etc., whatever is in your plan, will be selecting people and sending them where they need them, in the ED or outside the ED, on the floors, in the intensive care unit. They identify the gaps, and you should not be in our face, essentially. One entrance, one exit. And I personally believe that one companion with every patient should be allowed, especially with children. Why? Because you need them as transport. Two, because you need them to identify the patient and that you're giving the right treatment for the right patient. Because patients can go back and forth, move around. You will send them to CT scan. During the bomb blast, we had three scanners, the port blast of Beirut 2020. We had three scanners operating, and every scan had more than 25 patients in line. We had one or two patients arrest, deteriorate in line. You have to realize if you send them there, the transportation person will not be able to come back. So you need someone to stay with them, to identify them, because identification issues are important. Drill everybody on their duties in every department, the chief of staff, the hospital director. They should not know your plan only. They should know where they fit within the plan. The housekeepers, the nursing director, the admitting head, the support personnel, housekeeping. Everybody should be drilled and have their own. We use these categories, all of us, the red, the yellow, the green and the black. Well, I'll tell you two lessons. One, when I showed up during the bomb blast to my department and my juniors, my own former students who now are leaders, but I arrived there and Evelyn told me, I go, where do you need me? I came on my motorcycle so I can squeeze between the shattered glass and all the debris. So I arrived to the department 20 minutes, say we had people everywhere already. So when I showed up there, I came from Damour, which is 20 kilometers away from Beirut. So I arrived, I heard the bomb, I just came down. I didn't ask or call. So I parked and I walked in. A friend of mine called me with his wife injured from like 6 kilometers away, wife and daughter. I told him, go somewhere else. Very hard to say, just said, go somewhere else, because I knew it was necessary to use other resources. I show up there and she says, I need to go to the yellow zone. This is not the time to say, but I'm the one who intubates, I'm the most senior, I want to go to the red zone. Why? Why? Because people are doing CPR in every bed, or intubating and doing primary, secondary surveys. I mean, that's not what we need. The yellow zone is where you salvage people, where you find your own chair of your own department of radiology on the floor, bludgeoned on the floor with his wife, and nobody realizes he's on Coumadin with a brain injury. That's where you can salvage patients who can be salvaged but should be read or resuscitated. The yellow is a very critical area for assessment, reassessments, and you need the most experience there. That's where you need it. Leave the red to the surgeons. They're going to come down and they, you know surgeons, they're going to come down to the red zone. Give them the red zone. 1 hour later, half of them, all of them, will be in the operating room. So you don't have to worry about it. They'll clear up the place. Just send them with the patient and take over. In due time, it's okay. It's just resuscitation, primary, secondary survey. Go use your brain to operate your department the way it needs to be operated. Second lesson I want to talk about. I said, Send the green away. To send them to a floor that you in your own hospital where you send medical students with staples or something. Just, you don't need to have them in your face. And the black, that's in the NATO, you can use black. Black, he's dying, he's gonna die, he's celebrating, we're away, just let him die in a palliative area and let's just send him to the morgue or put him in a corner where it's quiet with his family so they can pray together. That you cannot do in Beirut. You cannot do in what you, I mean, yes, you obviously they're black, right? These shouldn't be brought in the department in the first place. Rescuers should know. But when you see the local mayor of Hamra in Beirut next to AUB carrying his own son with a gunshot wound in the eye and brain coming out from the other side, you don't say, hey, he's dead, take him to the black. You say, come my way, and you take him to the resuscitation room, and you just do barely enough to make sure the father knows that his son has been assessed and that some has been done to really heal them. Otherwise, you will be the next target, and they will blow up in your face. If you want to avoid turning black, do not say black. Do not say black. Use color colors to tag your nurses if you can. In Corona, it was hard. Everybody was blue. But you really need to tag them so that people know where your nurses are. And it's time for nurses to understand that the junior nurse in my department is their zone leader. Because the junior nurse knows where my medications are, where the supplies are, where the chest tube is, where the phone, how they know the plan of the ED, and they should lead. If you don't have enough people, first thing you need to take care and make sure there is somebody who's a disaster medical officer, also a disaster nursing officer, to clear the department, bring the stock, bring the supplies that you already have on the side, move the chairs out of the rooms, put them in the zone, green zone, clear the ED from every patient, over-admit them, or send them home immediately for delayed care. Make decisions. It's not time to charge. Just empty your department. That's your first step. Put somebody at the door to do triage. The triage is a different type of triage. This triage is a walk, it's a just to look at the patient. This is the triage. You look at them. Are they mentating? Are they posturing? Are they not? If they have cardiovascular collapse, they'll be out. So anybody who's unresponsive, who has decreased level of consciousness, you know, obviously in respiratory distress or unresponsive, such a patient will go to the red. Patients who are in pain but alert and oriented can go yellow. So, and people who are walking, they go green. So you make that decision. Who can make that decision? You don't have to be a doctor. You may need a doctor in the red zone and the yellow zone. That's your two primary problems. So where do you send them? You put a nurse, a senior nurse can do this job sometimes better than your own doctors. That's the order, and then you assume that there will be other people to come and help you, so when Kazi arrives on his motorcycle, go to the yellow zone. Okay? So, and then you have the green and the orange. I mentioned orange, that's actually next to the red. It's an expansion of the red zone. Do the primary in the resuscitation, do the secondary survey in the yellow. If they make it and then go, then don't go to the OR from the red zone or to the morgue. You need a Foley, you need an NG tube, you need the primary secondary survey. Move them out to a larger expanded area where other people can do the actual secondary survey. Leave a safety stock. Before the bomb blast in Beirut, we had almost 300, enough supplies and stock planned carefully to take care of patients. And we had the safety stock that we replenish every 3 months. And we have it ready. We prepared it 20 years ago. That list can be updated, but it's there. We have pre-registered clipboards and patients that are in the room because they are a different color than the usual clipboards. So brown versus red. You know, you can use color coding to know, to help you know where the patients are. Beware of electronic records. Electronic records can be useful in small scale activations, but when you have 800 people showing up and we did, you know, what do? You're going to use Epic to be able to really figure out what to do? We have Epic, yes. So what do you do? Epic will go beep, 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 they will blow up. You cannot use Epic in that situation. So that's when you use the surrogate that's with the patient transporting them. That's when you use medical students. 200 medical students can be very useful when they come from medical school. They will accompany, they will stay with the patients or within zones with the sole responsibility of making sure patients are correctly identified. Where do you put the ED triage? Outside your door or inside your door? Outside your door, they'd be stampeded on, so put them inside the door. Put the gates with a small opening you open just for the patient. Because when the ambulance comes, especially with militias or the clans, you have clans, you know, who come in, like the whole village comes down. When they come in one ambulance, you open the door, you have two casualties, and 10 people on top of them. And they will all come out and jump, and they want to carry the stretcher your way. When they carry the stretcher your way, what you do is you send your orderly to help with the stretcher, but instead of pushing your way, they push the other way. They actually slow them down, because these are literally torpedoes that will blast through anything. So strong steel doors that can handle a car, barely open, that open only to allow slow down torpedoes from coming in and be assessed by your triage personnel. They get wrapped, tagged, they get the paper clipboard, and they get directed yellow, green, or other. And it's, if you have conflicts between separating parties, you know, I don't want to get into specifics, but we have 18 sects in Lebanon. If they start killing each other, it's, or you have tribes, you have different, you know, constituents of the Lebanese community, and they're all outside the door. What you do, you need to separate them. If the police are coming from riots, and you have the rioters in the same place, you don't want to transport that into your department. So think about separating them or taking their clothes off. And even better, before bringing them in, agree with the pre-hospital personnel to try to separate them to different hospitals. That doesn't work all the time, but if you can do that, it's a good trick. Zero tolerance for non-medical questions. If you find people asking questions, where were you shot, how were you shot, who was there, who shot you, get them out of the department. That's your priority. Zero tolerance for non-medical questions. Secure the perimeter. I have started something that is considered probably unethical, but when people show up in my department asking me whether I need them and they're not on my list, you know, especially the hospital directors, what I do to them, I say, welcome, thank you for coming. Please, can you help the people outside, the security outside, hold the crowd outside? So I use them as actually body shields against the torpedoes and against the 400, 500, 1,000 people trying to walk into the department to see if their family members are inside. Remember, no phones, they cannot reach them, they can't find them. Everybody thinks that their family members is injured and they want to check every patient you have. So to prevent them, you put the steel barrier and a barrier of humans, your own security if you have any, but also your own volunteers who volunteer when you don't want them. Send them out, they want to smoke and because they're curious, they're happy anyway. Then they never say no, they are very agreeable to go out there. Consider the fact that police and security and army may not show up. They usually show up 6 hours later. They're usually in the field, they're occupied. And sometimes you don't even want them because they may be the ones who shot the people you have in your own department. So think about that and get smart. What's getting smart? It's first of all finding Mr. Smart. I have an expertise in that. I go outside and take a look around. I see somebody my height usually wearing a suit. That's why I don't like wearing suits, with a tie. They're a bit more stocky than that. They typically have a mustache, not always. But you go out there at the behind the security and you shout, who's in charge over here? And they point. Typically it's the guy who looks like that. Thank you for being here. You hold it. If he has a gun, that's the guy. So you, what you do is you say, I need your help. The moment you say, I need your help, Tomur Hakim, yes, what do you want, doctor? Can you please help me do a cordon here, secure a perimeter for me? 95% of the time, I would say, that's it. Two different words, Mustafa, Muhammad, Hala, the two words, they know each other. You get a cordon and everybody is away. It's peace. Occasionally you've chosen the wrong guy, but the point is you end up 2-3 more wounded. That's not a big deal. That's better than having them inside your department. So give the crowd or local stakeholders, prepare for these with your local community, the mayor, send the police from the municipality. You can have people in front of you. They're not all tertiary care centers. They may not have what I have at AUB, where I have security officers, you know, protection officers to come and help me. But you need to secure your perimeter and prevent people from burging into your department. That concept was used in Darfur, by the way. I'm not the one who started that, by the MSF. Direct crowds away, get smart. So when they show up, they want to know if my patients, you make a list, even if it's not complete, and you post it away on the other wall, like 500 meters away in the other main building. So they go over there. So there is a list. So they go check the list, and that's better. So you deflate them away. Two, you communicate with pre-hospital providers not to bring dead bodies into your department. So you don't have these explosions of emotions. And so what you do is you send them to the morgue. It succeeds in 30% of the time. They still bring people into you. And the best trick of all, and when they're coming in, you know, angry militia men or soldiers, they don't have to be militias, your local armed forces. When they're coming in very angry, you look at them, you say, come my way, come my way. And you never say, why are you bringing them here or slow down? Just opposite. Come here. Bring up to me. Bring them. The moment they see that they come your way, you say, who's in charge here? And you'll always have an alpha person who's going to say, him, who's the leader of the gang. Is there a relative? I need you to come with me, but we need blood. What do you mean you need blood? You need blood. Everybody will stop. The torpedo will take a halt and they'll say, take my blood. And you send them to the fifth floor blood bank on the other building where they hate me and they have a post for me saying dead or alive wanted. So, I mean, I send them all out there to give blood. So automatically you bring the other two with you and you can this way be able to resuscitate and take care of the patient with you. And if you think that they're dying, these patients are in bad shape, you engage them in a little bit of bagging, that's the black. You make them help you, and then you become their friend rather than their target. This issue, oh, he lives or you die, doesn't happen with me because I'm part of the team. They always think of you as part of the team when you engage them as members of the team that's doing the resuscitation. Patients will look like each other, keep the ED records with the patient, you know, keep the actual clipboard with the patient so you can know, check and recheck because they will locate. No media, don't talk to the media, no media. They, whatever you say, even if you're in control, they're gonna say, hammock, it's a disaster in the emergency department at the UB. They don't wanna hear everything is in control. Okay, so it's not your business to talk to the media, you have no time for that. Let the hospital disaster committee and director do that. And have a deputy from that director with you so that they take the information without you having to answer the call all the time. Remember to have shortwave radios, Wi-Fi, use WhatsApp, because cell phones will be down, SMS will be delayed. You really have a hard, beepers aren't being used. So remember communication is gonna be a challenge, and think about that. Think about preventable field mortality during transfers. Train people to properly transfer patients. So if you have a pneumothorax, don't intubate and send for a chest tube first. Make sure you have no unwanted volunteers and think about working in austere environments. Be ready to use ketamine and other things like that. Impose what kind of donations you expect from people. Do not take any donations people want to give you. They will give you things that are not useful, so they'll tax you. And remember that when you are dealing with something that's prolonged, do not all stay awake all night. Take turns, because they will come in at any moment. You may end up with Red Cross, you know, 10 ambulances arriving from the south, and you don't even know what to do. So you need to take turns and beware of fatigue, because you need to sustain activity 24/7 in the case of war. And think of the finances and who's going to pay for whatever other, you know, who's going to pay for the injuries, for the people who die, how you're going to compensate people if they stay with you for 33-day war. I mean, there are other aspects of preparedness that must be tackled. Dulce bellum in expertise are words written by Erasmus in the 13th century, and what they mean is war is delightful to those who have no experience of it. I'll entertain any questions. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Kazi. If you want, you can keep going to your second presentation.
I'm sorry?
If you want, you can keep going to your second presentation.
Thank you. Anybody has any questions for this one? Go ahead, because...
Developing emergency medicine in a developing nation with a fee-for-service payment system, challenges and opportunities.
Thank you, doctor. But I'll take a question on this.
Yeah, dear chair, I have a question. Can I do? I have a question. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Kazi, for this nice, impressive sharing. It was really very nice. You have 24 lessons. I got it. Very nice. Everyone is very nice. I want to pay attention, especially about the be aware about our limitation. You mentioned we have to know, be aware about fatigue. This is really very important. We have this problem in Maraş, Karaman, Maraş earthquake, for example. There was not any staff. So we have very limited number of the staff. They have to stay for 4 years, five nights. What do you think about this issue? The second, my second question was that, for example, the disaster doesn't come to another place only. Sometimes they come to the hospital also. And the hospital may collapse. We have this problem. There was no any other extra stuff. We just have the person who were at shift. and their relatives, father, children, they were also collapsed. Nobody can reach to the hospital. We had just only one or five person that can come for help. Only five person, a very big hospital. What do you think about, what can we do? What do you have suggestion for this issue? Thank you very much.
Thank you for asking these excellent questions. But I, in a way, alluded to them. To start with, not all incidents are the same. Like, for example, a bomb blast will injure people from all different factions in Lebanon. It's different than when you have, street riots or fighting on the streets. When you have fighting on the streets with, battles of the sort, you end up with no crowds at your door. You have 20, 30 people, 40 people, but you don't have 1,000 people trying to come in. So the crowds coming in are, it's not always, you need to have the experience to know that an air raid, an earthquake, different incidents have a different impact on different things. Things like available resources, things like crowd control, they have different flavors depending on the type of incident it is. But if you have a single incident with a large number of people, I gave you some rules to do how to manage crowds. With regard to fatigue, there was in the last slide a section on austere environment. In the interest of time, I didn't go into this, but I'll tell you that at the end of the day, I mentioned ketamine, right? At the end of the day, I can tell you that when we had 800 people in our department, we were not able to provide the same level of care that we usually provide on every day. So the first rule, we have even published an article, some of our own residents, literally talking about how hard it was for them, how much they cried, because they couldn't do the things they do normally for patients. So, I'm sorry, I'm talking to you and I'm getting a little bit of goose skin thinking about those moments. They're unforgiving, doctor. Yes, you have an austere environment where you may not even have power or things to give to your patients. And that's a fact of the matter, okay? You really want to help, but you cannot help. So it's unforgiving, but you really need to do your best by taking care of the ones you can save and keep alive, and the ones where you have the capacity to intervene and save them. And this requires the experience of the people working in the department. Additional help, you have to be creative. I mentioned how you can use the local policemen, local community volunteers, who many times just show up. I have not had at any time, a shortage of people willing to help me. But the people who were willing to help us from the community often were not qualified. I mean, did I not see people who needed cervical spine immobilization be brought by blankets or carried on their back? I mean, we all see that. Is it ideal? No, it's not. Have we stapled wounds that had glass in them? Have we told people with glass injuries to go home and come back the next day to be repaired? Have medical students taken care of faces the way they should? Have we repaired and re-repaired some of these injuries later? Yes, we do. You have to be creative, doing the best you can with the resources you have. You mentioned to me families. In my department, we have eight board certified physicians. Three of us had direct injuries in our families. Mazen was taking care of his wife and child. Gilbert brought his own son. He was just next to the airport, was injured. He was 200 meters away. This whole apartment was injured. The head of our pharmacy and risk management were injured. The chair of radiology was injured. I can't tell you. And no one knew he was on the floor. I mean, it wasn't his wife. I couldn't even recognize him. So in the yellow zone. So we get injured in our families, of course, and that's very harsh and hard. But, I can tell you that's the best we can do. So I don't know how to answer your question 100%. Fatigue, yes, fatigue. Why did I mention fatigue? Because I have been exhausted staying up all night with the staff, and then I get hit with people who arrived unannounced from another hospital, evacuated unannounced to us from the south of Lebanon, arriving It was the Red Cross. They had no communication. They just arrived. 12 casualties. I was too exhausted. I know that I could have been a better doctor that day. So, nevertheless, that's what I could do. So we accept those models. Okay, thank you. Hope I answered you right. The next talk I want to tell you is really about reimbursement models. I think I have maybe 10 minutes, right? 10 minutes. I don't have the answers to everything, but because I came to Lebanon and I was able to succeed in establishing the specialty in Beirut, you know, for many of you who may not know me enough, I'm the past president of the American Academy of Emergency Medicine. So I trained at UCLA graduate, trained in Detroit, and spent 16 years as a faculty at the University of California and in Detroit at Henry Ford Hospital. So I'm used to the American model, and I came to Lebanon and started alone with residents and developed a residency program that's ACGME accredited. So we are Joint Commission accredited, NAGNET accredited. So it's transplanted the place into Beirut. And from that, we ended up with another 3 or 4 residency program showing up in the country. Now, when I arrived there, I had to deal with the fact that we had a fee-for-service national model and was dealing with a situation where in many countries, I'm sure Turkey had to face those same issues and maybe facing them still, but the emergency department is an undervalued service by institutions, by administrators, by patients, by authorities, and the rest of the medical staff. They all were undervaluing the service, just complaining. They want more, but they give it less value and less support. They don't give them equipment, they don't give them staff, and they don't give them any adequate access to hospital resources. This was the way emergency medicine started in many countries, including Turkey, I'm sure. So we had limited ED leadership, limited support for them. They were part-timers who were given, usually the worst surgeon or the worst internist was left there to take care of it because they had nothing else to do. They would assign them something and not give them any resources to work. There was little effort to capture expenses, true expenses, or generate revenue out of the emergency department. And nobody was out there to properly secure support and resources. The EDs needed support for the structure, for operations, for coverage by attendings, by physicians, by nurses, and needed people to run the place. It's a full-time job when you have 30,000 patients a year. It's a full-time job. When you have more than that, you need assistants, assistant medical directors. What if you have an academic responsibility also? Here we go. We have 3 leaders you need for a department. Then there are pre-hospital services that may be deficient, you may not have a proper space, proper design, and you have difficulty with providing proficient, qualified, trained, credentialed staffing by nurses, by technicians, phlebotomists. There is no adequate continuing education, and there is no true citizenship or stewardship. There are no stylets, there are no Yankauer suctions, you have no suction, no proper tools. In Egypt, I remember touring with the Minister of Health in their biggest institution. They had no defibrillator in the emergency department. They had to take the patient to the 5th floor. So today, I'd like you to start thinking, what are the models of reimbursement and reimbursement regulations in your own country? Have they helped advance the specialty or impeded its growth? Is reimbursement competitive in emergency medicine with other specialties? Are you being compensated the same way? Is it undercompensated and reducing interest by excellent students and physicians to practice, train, or stay in emergency medicine? What are the strengths, weaknesses, and pitfalls of the compensation system that allowed your specialty to grow? And what are billing regulations that you think that will protect the specialty and you would like to see advanced? These are good points to start to think about. In general, remember, you think of people either paying or somebody else is paying for them. Right? That's a simple way. Either they pay or someone else pays. So in Lebanon, we had cash self-pay. We had people with private insurance. You had employees who had developed their own plans of a cooperative that they administered themselves. And you have then cooperatives of national groups or special industry groups. And then you have the labor ministry has something known as National Social Security Fund, which is almost a third of the population of Lebanon. And what they do is they also set rates and determine what and how many can people can be paid for every admission, who gets paid and who doesn't. You have then Ministry of Health Coverage. So the Ministry of Health Coverage is when, for example, people have no money. So if they don't go to a private hospital, there are allocated budgets that can be spent on under non-funded patients. And that's the sad trick. So in 2006, I took care of 3,000 patients in my department, including 12 dead and 120 wounded, 270 admissions, and more than 300, injured patients admitted. The Ministry of Health paid the whole department for 33 days of work, $260 for 33 days. That's like 8 cents per patient. How can you provide coverage for 33 days? How can you pay people to take care of patients if you're going to give them 8 cents? So obviously it's not, we need to know the details because the devil is always in the detail. It's easy to go on national TV and say everybody's covered, but de facto people aren't. Many, and they hide behind rules, like things like, oh, the Ministry of Health covers only inpatient admissions, they don't cover outpatient. Oh, you're not on the formulary, your specialty is not on the formulary, so sorry, we don't pay emergency physicians, we pay the admitting doctor only. Let them pay you. Take away from them. So that's not going to happen. And then you have armed forces medical insurance coverage. And we have many. We have the Sûreté Générale, the immigration police. We have the customs police. We have the internal security police. And then you have the Lebanese army. And every one of them has their own form of coverage and rules. Very fragmented. And background, we have 163 institutions that claim to be private, sorry, to be hospitals. De facto, some of them are not, don't exist due to corruption. Some of them are just small little dispensaries or units that are called hospitals, just for funding purposes. We have 138 private and almost 25 public hospitals. Public hospitals are supposed to be 100% free. We do have a lot of doctors, two for every 1,000 person in Lebanon, and our pre-hospital sector is based on volunteers. Now, hospital models, we have private, but we also have, we said we have government hospitals. There's also an army-owned army hospital, where most of the time the scanner is broke. And then you have university hospitals that are supposed to be not-for-profit, and that's supposed to be as big. And then you have university, but that because their bills can be big. And then you have hospitals that convince universities to call them affiliated. So they do exchanges. They provide students, residents that rotate between the two, and they have accordingly affiliation. They work somewhat for profit still. And there are government hospitals that have established affiliation. Again, fragmentation that leads to a lot of chaos in reimbursement models and reimbursement activity. So let's start with everybody wants affordable emergency care. So if you ask people and administrators and policy leaders, politicians, what do you want for patients? Every patient is entitled to affordable emergency care. Ideally, affordable to them means free. Somebody else should pay for it, not me. To insurance patient, affordable means how can I coerce facility and providers to accept the least reimbursement for providing excellent care or care. To the government, affordable becomes restricting access to resources, to limit utilization, to only when it's most needed and it's when it's difficult to say no to patients. Outcome, fragmented, heterogeneous, overlapping, where people in the same family or the same person may have national coverage by the fund and have private insurance, where patients have to pay out of pocket in addition to insurance to be accepted for certain specific procedures that are negotiated. A lot of, you go into a private government hospital, but the surgeon will not operate, they'll have their students operate unless you pay them money, tip outside without telling anything. anybody. So there is a lot of overlap and a lot of confusion and corruption. The terms of coverage and benefits also change. Pre-existing injuries, pre-existing diseases, the illnesses that occur within the last month, you know, there will psychiatric issues, dental complications, you can, there's a, you know, coverage that varies from one to the other. And then you have accreditation requirements by heterogeneous entities. So you have Ministry of Health accreditation, you have Magnet, Joint Commission. There is actually an agency from Turkey that comes and accredits also institutions in Lebanon. And you have diagnostic centers that usurp, where doctors send patients to do their labs other than their own institutions. And they do that so they can get the kickback later. You have corruption. You have 5,000 GPs in Lebanon. People wanted to be a doctors. That shouldn't be a lot, these 5,000 GPs, except they're 5,000, but they're almost, they're more than a third of our doctor population who are still practicing in Lebanon. They're almost 40% of our population of doctors. Some of them are excellent, some of them are not at all. Some of them cannot handle health care or medical care or acute care. Yet, there is political activity that puts them in certain positions that where they can do that. A lot of bad habits among healthcare professionals who can bill patients while traveling, who can bill patients they haven't seen, who don't come to see their patients where they do overbilling for private insurance. And you come in there trying to fix something, and they all tell you, follow the NSSF, National Security Fund. What are their rules? NSSF was established in 1960. There was no emergency medicine. They pay only for inpatient care, you're outpatient. And they don't pay for you because you're not existent yet. And when you are existent, they tell you, you're not everywhere. Why should I pay here and not there? And if they, then they go to, why should we pay you for care? Let them pay you, why should we? And then you're not on the formulary, or we don't know that they should. So, and then private insurers use that as an excuse not to pay you. Why should we pay you if the national fund doesn't? In 1960, there were no defibrillators. 1960, there were no CAT scans. There were no thrombolytics. People did not do laparoscopy. So sometimes you have to upgrade your laws and rules and regulations to match the reality. They cap the number of consultants, they chop you off. Your colleagues will conspire to take your bill out. They are all happy with billing, with collecting together, but you're the new kid on the block. They don't want you. There is bundling. There is also issue of coverage. Are you really covering the department or not? This is the American University of Beirut, with a 200-year-old university, and this is my hometown where I live in Damour. Any questions?
Thank you, Dr. Kazi. Any question? Not only for Dr. Kazi, also Dr. Daniels.
Please.
You have a question, audience?
Thank you for presentation. I have a complicated question about these solutions about the payments of us and emergencies. What do you consider to act behavior to the other administrators, specialties or chief positions of the hospital to solve this? Do we act rigid or hard or is friendly or soft? What do you think?
What is the best way to secure reimbursement for emergency physicians in your country? Is that your question?
For example,
What strategies to use?
Yes.
To be
yes. Soft strategy or to be hard? Okay. I ask for it.
I'll tell you how it works. In general, when you have universal care, when the government, when the authority decides payment, the first battle you should seek, the first victory you should seek, is parity with other colleagues. So, parity with other colleagues within the institution where you're practicing. You cannot say that every hospital is the same way than others. And exactly. Of course, you do know that some surgeons working in certain areas or certain hospitals may not be as qualified or as in your university hospital. So you cannot say everybody gets paid the same. You really need to make sure your first goal is to secure that your specialists are getting paid by the payers The same way, whether it's private insurers, cash payer, or the consultation you get should be similar to theirs. How can you cap it in the emergency department? How do you avoid paying for two people at the same time? I'll give you some tools. Other ways, because we did that in Beirut. So you collect all the money in a pool every month, and you divide it based on the number of consultations, including your colleagues who come to the department. Why is that important? Because when you give retribution for them for showing up, and you collect the money you collect from the government, from private patients, when you collect the money and you distribute the collection for the patients from month of September 2023, it becomes an open account. Any money that comes in gets distributed automatically via the proportion to everybody who was involved in providing care in that month. And you can then build incentives for higher acuity, for nighttime coverage. It may sound complicated, but it's actually a mathematical formula. I've done that in Beirut for the last 13 years. We never had a problem. So you incentivize people who come from home. You incentivize people who come at night, weekends, holidays. So you give a higher 1.4, 1.2, and the day shift, day midday of the week becomes a lower amount of revenue. And you make their share equal to yours, except for the coefficient, based on acuity and time of the day. So by doing this, you are already making everybody work with you to limit the number of unnecessary consultations. That is, of course, you're no longer fighting over every patient, but they will never start asking, everybody to come in. You become better doctors and more efficient doctors by doing that. And that's one model that can help make everybody work together. Another model you can use is the issue of competition. Look, we're facing it in Lebanon. At AUB, the biggest battle I won was the battle of reimbursement. When I was able to get the money because the trustees said, give them the money, the government of my university said, give the money to the department, they're your equal. When I won that battle, trust me, I made a lot of enemies. I had cardiologists making money all the way from France. Hello, on the phone call, then the resident or the fellow will come and put the bill. And they were putting an emergency bill. So, and then, there is only one emergency bill. You cannot have many. They are consultants, not primary. So when you want to reorganize that, you're dealing with colleagues who are making lots of money, easy money, on every Foley, every NG. So to avoid that, two tricks to do that, because they said, first of all, you stand firm. We want parity with colleagues. And that cost me my position at the time. I was offered the job, but I had to sign what they wanted. I didn't. I refused the job. So they had to find an alternative, and they had to fight with all my colleagues. I may be bad, not everybody is bad, because when you are fighting for something that is fair for every one of your colleagues, for the welfare of the specialty, your colleagues will be there with you. So we won it a year later and got what we wanted. So this is technical, because what is going to happen is sometimes the institution is going to want to take the money and give you a salary, a very small salary compared to others. No, you're specialist like everybody else. You must win the battle of parity in your institution. How do you do that? What are tools to avoid? Why, Kaiser is an HMO in America. How do they decide what to pay their employed doctors? They cannot hire anyone if they don't pay them similar to the people in the private market. So in Lebanon, I've trained in the last 12 years since we opened the residency program in 2011. We graduated 30 people. We've retained 10. 10 are in the Western world, Europe and United States already, and 10 others are in the Gulf region. And why do they leave? When I started, they used to pay doctors in Lebanon in emergency medicine 10% of what they're getting paid now. In the Gulf region, they're paying them 4 times the amount. So, 10%,
congrats.
10% of X versus 4 times X. So, the market, the competitiveness will resolve this issue. If you want emergency, good qualified emergency physicians, you need to do that. So let the market help you gain these changes. Now, you must also accept the fact that in Lebanon, which is the size of Orange County, 6 million people, we don't need 150 emergency department. You need categorization of these hospitals where the tertiary care centers, where the high acute are distributed properly, that's a national plan for the minister, and where the people there are qualified. Other places can have GPs who have telemedicine support, who have an administrative support. You can create a tier two. I know it's hard to accept that, but I come from the United States, the American Academy of Emergency Medicine, where only board certified physicians should do this. In the rest of the world, you have to have a tier one, tier two. The tier two are going to end up being working in the rural places and in less privileged places with support from the main, but also you don't expect them to do the things you do. You need to create a trauma system where patients that have the stroke units, cardiac cath, are limited to places where you have the best of the best, and you pay the best of the best in parity with the people in that institution. That's it. I hope that helped.
Thank you.
If there is no question, this session will end it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Very good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Indu Lata from India, and basically I'm an obstetrician and dealing with high-risk pregnancy. And the today's topic of my talk is emergency transfusion in pregnant trauma patients. I think you all are dealing with pregnant patients in your emergency department. So there is nothing to declare, and I would like to thank Wasim team, organizer, to give me this opportunity to have here. So the objectives of my talk is management of pregnant trauma patients, prevention of RH isomerization, transfusion principles and risk, and blood and blood products transfusion. So trauma during pregnancy is the leading cause of non-obstetric maternal mortality. And it almost, there is 20% of maternal deaths are directly attributable to injury. Trauma-related mortality among pregnant patients are lower than the non-pregnant patient because there are various factors like due to hormonal and physiological effects in pregnancy, like there is increase in blood volume, there is increase in red blood mass in the circulation, and as well as the relative and husband of the woman is more aware about the pregnancy and related complications in a trauma event. The causes of trauma during pregnancy are motor vehicle collision, domestic or intimate partner violence, penetrating trauma, blunt trauma, falls, and electric trauma also. And there are various complications also due to trauma. These are placental abruption, uterine rupture, preterm labor, leaking per vaginam, and direct fetal injury. Like if there is fracture of pelvis of the pregnant woman, then it can cause direct fetal skull fracture and injury to the fetal brain. So as we all know that the management starts with primary survey. If any patient get traumatic, then every injured patient of childbearing age should be considered pregnant until proven otherwise. Multiple injury and hypovolemic shock in pregnant patient are most appropriately managed using ATLS principles. And after admission to emergency department, every woman should have a pregnancy test to rule out pregnancy, that patient is pregnant or non-pregnant. Following ABCD principles, we have to assemble appropriate personnel like trauma team, interventional radiologist, obstetrician and neonatologist to take care of that patient. Airway and breathing, first we have to follow A, that is established patent and protected airway, and we have to maintain breathing to make the oxygen saturation more than 95%, which leads to the continuous oxygen supply to the fetus and making it safe. So in circulation, we have to maintain circulation by placing two large bore IV lines like 14 or 16 gauge, rapidly infuse a crystallized bolus solution like ring electrolyte or normal saline, approximately 1 liter, to get the desired response until the blood arrives. Or whenever the blood is available, then we can transfuse blood or blood products. We have to control also the external hemorrhage. The patient is bleeding from external site, then we can stop that bleeding by direct pressure or by using of tourniquets. And as same, the indication for extra exploratory laparotomy are the same in the pregnant patient as in non-pregnant patients. So basically the aim is to restore maternal arterial blood pressure with blood products, base resuscitation to maintain uteroplacenta perfusion and prevent unnecessary fetal compromise. In medical management, we can use tranexamic acid 1 gram intravenous slow over 15 minutes, and it can also prevent the bleeding from any site. Vasopressor is usually reserved for patient in whom evidence of inadequate organ perfusion is present and where there is failure in response to further volume administration. And in all pregnant patients, we should also use the left uterine displacement if the uterus is 24 weeks up to umbilicus or above the umbilicus. Like this, if we have more members in our team, then we can use both hand method or by single hand method. Or if there is no one is available, then we can tilt the patient bed up to 30 degree by putting towel or something and make the tilt left side up to 30 degree. After that, the resuscitation of pregnant patient, and whenever the blood is available, we should follow the standard fixed ratio major hemorrhage transfusion protocol like fresh frozen plasma, platelet and PRBC in the ratio of 1:1:1. And we should use cryoprecipitate concentrate whenever there is need of FFP, because if we give FFP, then there is higher risk of fluid overload. And we should follow this blood products transfusion by the hemoglobin, hematocrit, and coagulation studies like PT, INR, and APTT. And the products are given by by a point of care test like TAG or ROTAM to guide ongoing blood product replacement appropriately. So this is a study published in 2020. In this study analyzed the two trials like CRASH-2 and WOMAN trials, in which they have seen that the patient with the traumatic hemorrhage and with postpartum hemorrhage, if the time from this event to admission to emergency department is more than 3 hours, then there is need of transfusion, blood transfusion. So we can decrease this blood transfusion related side effects by decreasing this time interval between the event and the hospital admission. So after ABC triage, we have to take thorough history of the patient about the mechanism of injury and possible damage, previous obstetric history, like if there is previous cesarean, previous myomectomy, or previous bad obstetric history, or in present pregnancy, what are the complications like preeclampsia or diabetes. After that, we have to physically examine the patient, general examination, systemic and obstetric examination to see the condition of the pregnant patient. Maternal assessment also done by the laboratory tests like hemoglobin, hematocrit, white blood cells, coagulation profile, and the imaging methods like abdominal ultrasound, plain radiograph of spine, chest and pelvis, and CT scan. But these all should be done as per local protocol and need to know extent of injury in polytrauma or severe hemorrhagic shock. Fetal assessment can be done by monitoring of fetal heart rate and uterine activity, and evaluation of maternal fetal hemorrhage and prevention of RH isomerization should be seen. Like if there is a patient of injury or trauma and she is RH negative pregnancy, or patient is not known, the RH status is not known, then we should give a single dose of injection anti-D immunoglobulins 300 microgram within 72 hours of any injury to protect the maternal fetal hemorrhage. And in condition where we predict that the maternal fetal hemorrhage is more than 30 ml, then we have to perform clear bed count, and we can quantify this maternofetal hemorrhage, and we might need the additional doses of injection anti-D immunoglobulins. So this is the mechanism of development of RH isomerization. When the mother is RH negative and fetus is RH positive, then this RH positive, due to maternal fetal circulation, these RH positive antigen create a immune system response, and these mother body response is formation of antibodies against this RH antigen of the baby. So these antibodies after formation get back into the fetal circulation and causes damage to the fetus. So the principle of transfusion in pregnancy should be a valid consent, and if the condition is not feasible at that time, then we can inform retrospectively to the patient and patient relatives. Documentation of reason why we are transfusing the blood, we should mention in patient record. All women should have their blood group or antibody status checked at the time of booking or at the time of 20 weeks of gestation. And if patient RSD status is not known, then we can transfuse ABO negative, RSD negative, and CAL antibodies negative red cell units directly to the patient. And there should be a clear local protocol on how to manage major traumatic and obstetric hemorrhage. And in critical bleeding, we have to use the Rotem or tag-based algorithm to guide our transfusion. So this is the picture of tag, which tells about this is the graph that tells about which blood product is required to transfuse. So transfusion-related adverse effects are many, like acute and delayed hemolytic transfusion reactions, transfusion-transmitted bacterial infections, anaphylaxis, or transfusion-related acute lung injury like trolley. And risk of isomerization as if mother is RH negative. And most common, the human error. So we should do safe transfusion because we have to give right blood, right patient, right time, and at right place. If it doesn't happen, there might be acute hemolytic reaction from ABO incompatibility, which may be fatal. So target which we have to achieve is guided by this lethal diamond, that we have to prevent hypocalcemia, acidosis, hypothermia, and coagulopathy. And our target is pH should be more than 7.2, lactate should be less than 4 millimole per liter, calcium should be more than 1.1, platelet should be more than 50,000, and PTNR should be less than 1.5. So we can transfuse many types of bloods if patient comes in emergency and we don't have time to cross match and all that, then we can give directly O negative blood group with RSD negative uncrossed red blood cells. Or if we have time, then we can give group specific blood transfusion. And if we have more time to cross-match the blood fully than we give fully cross-matched blood. We should use rapid infuser and blood warming device to give these transfusion. So in fresh frozen plasma, the dose is 12 to 15 milligram per kilogram of body weight, and it is determined basically the clinical indication, pre-transfusion and post-transfusion coagulation test and clinical response. And the PT and APTT should be maintained less than 1.5 times of the normal value. The infusion rate should be 10 to 20 milliliter per kg per hour. And FFP should not be used to reverse warfarin. If the patient is on warfarin, we should not give FFP to reverse the action of warfarin. We should give patient prothrombin complex. In cryoprecipitate, the typical adult dose is 2-5 donor pools. That is, one pool of cryoprecipitate contains the fibrinogen, factor 7, factor 13, and one bilirubin factor from 5 units of whole blood. And it will raise fibrinogen concentration by 1 gram per liter in average adult. And it is administered at the same rate as previously. If you intend to use cryoprecipitate, then it should be thawed because it remains in frozen condition. So we have to tell our bank to thaw it if we want urgently. And the aim of fibrinogen level should be more than 2.5 gram per liter. Cryoprecipitate should be used group specific. Whatever the group of patient, then we should use that group cryoprecipitate only. In platelets, one adult therapeutic dose should be given, and it is typically raise the platelet count by 20 to 40,000, and it should be given over 30 to 60 minutes. Platelets should not be transfused through a giving set already used. Imagine we are giving the blood transfusion and we use same the delivering set or same set to transfuse the platelet. This should not be done. Start transfusion as soon as possible after component arrives in the clinical area. So this is all about the component of the blood products. And we should
know. So we are left with 1 more minute.
Oh. So we should know the massive blood transfusion, and it may be needed to initiate a major trauma, obstetrical hemorrhage. And in adults, massive transfusion may be defined as transfusion of half of one blood volume in 4 hours or more than one blood volume in 24 hours. Or we can define as more than 5 unit RBC in 4 hours or more than 10 unit RBCs in 24 hours. And causes could be of giving massive blood transfusion could be obstetric or incidental causes due to trauma like rupture splenic artery aneurysm, hepatic rupture or trauma. So this is the protocol to give massive transfusion. In round one, we give 6 units of every product, that is PRBC, FFP, platelet and cryoprecipitate. In round two, same protocol. In round three, we give medical management in form of tranexamic acid.
Sorry, speakers, last minute, please. Last minute, thank you.
And fourth round, we give all products except cryoprecipitate. And if there is no relief in bleeding, then we can reactivate this protocol. So take-home message is any pregnant trauma patient with hemorrhagic shock should be managed with ATLS principles. Aim of transfusion is to restore maternal arterial blood pressure to maintain uteroplacental perfusion to prevent unnecessary fetal compromise. Blood and blood products are life-saving but carry a small risk of adverse effect. And it should follow the standard fixed dose, fixed ratio major hemorrhage transfusion protocol like 1:1:1. And injection Rh antid immunoglobulin should be given to Rh negative pregnancy to prevent Rh isomerization in pregnant trauma patients. Thank you.
In the interest of time, we'll be taking questions right at the end of the session, if that's all right with everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Moving on from a vast and general topic to a very specific, specialized, super specialized, super duper specialized topic. cardiac oncology in the ED.
It's Dr. Katia
M. Lugo. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, everyone. It's really an honor to be presenting at WASM 2023. I got appointed with this topic, cardiac oncology, right? Which one I used to? This one? Okay, sorry. So cardiac oncology in the emergency department, right? It's a new topic. Why it's important to discuss this? Cardiovascular disease and cancer has been the leading cause of death for years, right? We have noticed a decrease in the cancer death through the years, but we have noticed an increase in the cardiovascular death on the cancer survivor patients, right? This is what is bringing the importance of the cardiac oncology. We need to create a multidisciplinary team to deliver the integrated and personalized approach on patient care. So this is a new topic. It's a new field in cardiology and also hem-onc, and now it's going to be a new topic in the emergency room that is aimed to reduce the morbidity and mortality and to improve the quality of life of patients surviving cancer. They concentrate in preventing, diagnosing, and treating in the cardiotoxicity and result from chemotherapy and radiotherapy, right? It's how we're gonna identify these patients earlier to start the treatment, the prognosis, and the prevention. And if they develop the cardiotoxicity, to identify early to also minimize the deterioration on their cardiac status. The most feared complication of the chemotherapy or radiation is the cardiotoxicity, but it's not the only complication that you're going to see. So cardio-oncology is, as we talk, is a whole treatment plan, right? The patient gets diagnosed with cancer. They're going to get the evaluation to re-stratify the cancer to select what is the best treatment. Once they select the treatment for the cancer for breast, if it's going to be radiotherapy or it's going to be the chemo, they're also going to be assessing this patient for the cardiovascular risk, right? They're going to be assessing these patients with EKGs, cardiac enzymes, proBNP, cardiac imaging, and they're going to risk stratify the cardiovascular risk, and then they're going to target the best treatment of the cancer and also how to minimize the potential complications of the treatment in their heart and also how to identify early to start treatment to minimize those effects also. Once they develop, they're going to start the cancer treatment and they're going to do the follow-up that they need for the cardiovascular status. Right, these patients, how you re-stratify, you start like every patient with history and physical, right? They're gonna have the same risk factors that the normal population in addition to the chemotherapy that we're gonna mention. So they could have, if they could be sedentary, obese, high alcohol intake, they could have the same cardiovascular risk factors of smoking, arterial hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol, right? Also, they could have already history of myocardial disease, heart failure, valvular disease, arrhythmias, and they could have cardiomyopathy or hypertensive ventricular failure. But now we need to add the risk of cancer treatment and anthracyclines radiotherapy, right? When we see patients in the emergency room with a chief complaint of chest pain, right, we apply the TIMI score, we apply the heart score, all those, but none of them yet has the cancer as a risk factor, right? And it's not only ongoing cancer, it's also resolution of the cancer because they already received the treatment. Now we should be considering that as a risk factor on these patients. So I mentioned some of the studies that we're going to be doing include the EKG, the cardiac enzymes. One of the baseline, you always get a baseline echocardiography, right? What you're going to be seeing in the emergency room, not all the time we do echoes in the emergency room, but you could compare if the patient comes with chest pain and has history of cancer, previous cancer, and they got treated or resolved, they have, you know, now they have that increase. And if they have a echo done about 3 months ago, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later, and you notice a decrease in the most recent one, and no one is adding those dots together, it could be you identifying the risk of cardiotoxicity. If they have a sudden decrease in the ejection fraction, or the ejection fraction in less than 50, that's highly concerning for cardiotoxicity. Other factor that they're looking is the global longitudinal strain in the left ventricle. They have, the studies have shown that that change of more than 50% is going to be even earlier sign compared to the changes on the echo in the ejection fraction. So if you notice the global longitudinal strain to be increased, that patient should be evaluated by the cardiology early, and also in combination with the hematology oncologist. So this is an example of some of the medications that are related to cardiotoxicity. Mainly is the anthracyclines and also the radiotherapy and the HER. Why they cause the cardiotoxicity? Because they have affect the DNA double strand breaks, and also it could cause damage in the mitochondria. Also, the HER caused direct damage to the cardiomyocytes. Some of the examples of the surveillance that they plan with these patients, right? Once you classify this patient as low, moderate, high, and very high risk, mainly the low and moderate is going to be very similar to screening, and the high and very high are going to be also similar in their comparison. So you're going to have a baseline of the troponins and the proBNPs, and every two cycles for those low and moderate risk, you're going to repeat those studies. That's while they're on the chemotherapy. And this is going to vary with the medication that they're receiving for the chemo or that they receive. That's why it's important that it's a combination with cardiology and also hematology, oncology. For the high risk, it's going to be a baseline, but also they're going to be follow up with the every cycle of the treatment. Now, once they finish the chemotherapy, they're going to be, for the low risk and moderate risk, it's going to be within the 3 months after the treatment that you're going to start the enzymes follow up, and also 12 months for the echocardiogram. What is going to vary with the high risk and very high risk is that you're going to do the echocardiogram sooner and also more frequent the enzymes. This is another example with another of the medications that I'm not going to go over, but you see the difference on the surveillance. Other pathologies that you could see with the cardiovascular effects of the chemotherapy and radiation is aortic disease, right? You're going to get the porcelain aorta. Also, you could have what we mentioned, heart failure and cardiomyopathies. You could have pericarditis and restrictive pericarditis, microvascular disease, valvular disease, rhythm and conduction abnormalities, cardiac ischemia, and atherosclerosis. So going to also, in addition to the cardiotoxicity, when you see patients that they started the chemotherapy and suddenly they were having normal blood pressure and suddenly they're having elevated of the blood pressure, you need to consider that that could be a reaction due to the chemotherapy. We should not take or tell them that they need to stop the chemo. Many times what they do with those medications that is causing this is to decrease the dose of the chemotherapy until they start getting better, because some of these cases could be reversible. Or they could be started in ACE inhibitors or calcium channel blockers. Right. Also, when these patients present with arrhythmia, that the most common are AFib, and also they could have QT changes. But when you're seeing AFib and they need also anticoagulation, these patients are prone to more complications due to anticoagulation. So the recommendation is to start with the low heparin as much as possible. And if it's needed, then to do a short course of the IV heparin. The patients also could develop valvular disease, as I mentioned before. and these valvular disease complications can take almost 10 years to start presenting, right? And it could go from regurgitation to also, they could present with infective endocarditis. So you need to have a high suspicion in an immunocompromised patient after cancer treatment, and it could take even 10 years because they could be, the valvular presentation could be due to infective endocarditis. So the interdisciplinary approach with including cardiology and hem-onc in these patients that are presenting to the emergency department with chest pain with a previous history of cancer or current history of cancer. This is a more complex graph of what happened after. That is mainly you re-stratified. That is how we see the patient with chest pain in the emergency room and the follow-up that they're getting afterwards. So why is important cardio oncology in the ED? It's they have the consensus and also the, how they make the diagnosis of the cardiotoxicity. As I mentioned before, a change of the decrease in the left ventricular ejection fraction more than 10% or a global decrease in the ejection fraction less than 50 that they mentioned that is mainly 40, the goal, and the global longitudinal strain, a reduction of more than 15%, it has a high possibility. So what is important to take a good history in the emergency department, known if that patient has history of previous cancer or current treatment. If you notice any sudden change in the blood pressure and this patient considered that it could be due to a new medication that they're receiving as a chemotherapy and they need to be treated immediately. And also, if you notice some increase in the baseline troponin or BNP, consider that it could be that this patient is going in the cardiotoxicity, and the early detection, the better for these patients. And always involve early cardiologists and oncologists in the ED. Thank you very much.
Any questions from the audience? If no, we'll move to the next. Thank you so much. Next speaker, Dr. Sandeep Sahu, whole blood transfusion in trauma shock, current trends.
It usually doesn't hurt to applaud, so let's do that. Yes, cheers.
Thank you, chairpersons. I am thankful to the organizer from the Turkey, especially Dr. Basar and Beshet, and it's really a privilege to speak in front of Professor Vincent, because a lot of friends from India, and we are listening to him so for years. So this whole blood transfusion in trauma shock, I'm going to present the current update or trends that is evidence in last 3 years. Namaskar, salam from India. And very very thankful to the VASM and APET physicians from the Turkey that you have given opportunity to share us. And it's very nice hospitality that we are enjoying for last 2-3 days. So what is the current status or evidence about whole blood? Whether it's true that old is gold and old wine or whiskey is definitely good as compared to new things, or I am speaking on new things, or it's already a debate is already clear which came first, because definitely here this is not the question here, because whole blood comes first, then the component comes. And when something comes first, we already have seen our seniors and other colleagues who are senior to us, they have already used this. And what is the current status in trauma? Because in emergency, other condition, there can be things that one patient needed only, like in dengue. Like in India nowadays, a lot of fever, and this is because of not dengue shock syndrome and dengue, and where we have to transfuse platelet and isolated component. But in trauma, that everything is losing. We are losing PRVC, we are losing platelet, we are losing coagulation factor, and we want to definitely give one, so that we get everything so that we have a good clot. So the first, the, as history says, blood transfusion started in 17th, and the blood banking started in 19th, and the hypothesis that all patient need not the component, because not whole blood, they given the concept that as per the patient need, it's good that we give PRBC or cryo or plasma or platelet. But what is the real thing now? Because in trauma, we are talking about 1:1, then we are talking about massive blood transfusion, and we want to have all the coagulation factor, platelet, and a good clot. And good clot needed a component, so you can weigh that. The day night is changing, the time is changing. It's not the day and night different, it's only a difference in the rotation. So same thing is here, whole blood is moving full circle. We started from World War I and II, and in these World War, all the military trauma, they have used the whole blood. The things move from 1960s, 70s, 90s, and again, the evidence from last 3, 4, 5 years, 2019 onward, they are saying we should focus on whole blood in trauma. Because one whole blood is not equal to one FFP plate in PRVC, definitely. When we want higher hemoglobin with little transfusion, when we want higher coagulation factor that is there in whole blood, when we want give less blood volume because it can take one trolley and transfusion associated problems, the answer is whole blood. Because it has everything excess. And only thing is that availability. If human has thought that they want to discover the world, they have done it. So if we reconsider it and we make it available, then we can't compare the whole blood with the component 1:1, because whole blood is better. Definitely there is advantage and disadvantage of both things, but there is advantages of whole blood. And as we are searching literature and we are coming not in medical science, but the social media also, they are saying that one whole blood is not one combination of PRBC, FFP and platelet. If we are trying to increase or recreate a whole blood, then it is not 1:1:1. So this proper randomized clinical trial that given us, initially the debate was 1:1:1 or 1:2:2, 1:1:2. So ratio debate is going on from the last 10 years, and ideally whether we are to achieve, especially the developing world. The developed country, I know they have their protocols and SOP, and they were able to do it. Because if we have ratio, then when we had the point of care testing. Because in India, nobody is everywhere. In developed country, they have the developing country, they have the point of care testing to assess the viscoelastic test that how they can target. So if we say this, the ratio debate 1:1 or 1:1:2, it does not result in significant difference. So research is emerging that shows that whole blood works better for these in trauma patient as compared to fraction component, and it's a rediscovery, it's not a new discovery. And whole blood versus component therapy in transfusion trauma patients, they're saying that mortality is less because you are transfusing less. Even the cost, because medical science, everything is cost. When you give multiple transfusion, every component has a cost, and also the cost to give it. So whole blood should be the lesser, lower charges and improved logistic, especially when trauma, when we are dealing with massive blood transfusions. This study in 2021, that is at USENTCOM, that is a Army, US Army, they have done 5-year prospective study, and 1,700 patients, those receive both the component and the whole blood, and they say whole blood use increased significantly with time in last 5 years, and because the supply is also increasing. And without a long-lasting platelet component, that is a problem with the component therapy, because we know that as the components of more than 14 days, this platelet is only working for first week, 3 to 5 days. Another study that whole blood transfusion versus component in adult trauma patient with major hemorrhage. So more than 3,000 patients that is compared in database and more than 1,800 records, 6 studies. So what this study says, no study reported worse survival with whole blood. However, there is significant evidence to support or reject the use of whole blood transfusion as compared to component therapy in trauma with massive hemorrhage. Another study, whole blood transfusion versus component therapy in trauma resuscitation, a systematic review and meta-analysis and in 2020. And this says that on this meta-analysis, whole blood transfusion was not assured with 24-hour mortality, the odds ratio as compared to the component therapy, whether it is 24-hour mortality or 30-day mortality. Another study by this Brill Jason, that impact of incorporating whole blood into hemorrhagic shock resuscitation analysis of 1377 consecutive trauma patients receiving emergency uncrossed blood products, and they say that it has improved survival because odds ratio is saying this. They have decreased need of overall transfusion amounts, 60% less component products needed in whole blood group, and effect of survival are good, especially in severe trauma patients. So this is published in JCS, that is American College of Surgeons. And in US, this group, Dr. Brian Cotton, they are working hard for last 5 years, where they say that low titer group O whole blood, LTOW, and they are promoting this, that that is re-emerging role of whole blood. And as we know, this is a walking blood banks. People in military, they have the blood groups, they have a screen, they have already know the blood type, and they are the walking blood banks. So they have the resources, and military is using for Afghanistan, Iraq war, and all the war areas. That is, and we are also, and nowadays we are talking a lot that this country is against this, and things are going on, and it may increase. So whole blood based resuscitation by using cold stored low titer O units, that is also FDA approved now. So this can be used. Only question that it is universal versus type specific blood, RH whole blood versus RH negative blood, or we can use safely in children. The answer is that. Answer is yes. Whole blood resuscitation is safe in pediatric trauma patients. This multicentric study that says that it can be safely used in pediatric trauma patients, 0 to 17 years. And another study is low titer whole blood, truly a universal blood product. This answer is that it appears to be a safe product for universal use across all blood groups. Group B recipient arrives with worse physiological value in shock, and they receive whether this whole blood or component. So another evidence is in 2021 in emerging blood transfusion for trauma patient with perioperative resuscitation standard of care. In 2021, whole blood transfusion is used especially in military scenarios and is also becoming more and more popular in civilian world, although it is accompanied by a strong lack of evidence. And so we need more things to study and explore so that the God gift can be used properly in saving life. Single institutions trial comparing whole blood versus balanced component 50 years later, where we are, we saying that whole blood is better, and it has less in-hospital mortality, less ventilator days and pulmonary edema and all that. A review in transfusion whole blood for trauma patient outcome at higher doses. So they say that we are now moving from 1:1 transfusions to the low titer group O whole blood transfusion, because the additives in the component therapy, they are also not increasing the oxygen carrying capacity, and they dilute the coagulation factor. So a lot of evidence. So in summary, by reviewing this 3 to 5 year recent evidences, whole blood used many years since its inception, that blood can be transfused in an human for saving life without any harm. It proven time tested in military trauma. Thousands patients, hundreds of studies, and evidences also emerging in civilian trauma. Only thing is that everything is life has advantage and disadvantage and risk. So same here with the component and the whole blood. Only thing that availability. If it is available, definitely, because in my residency in India, we have used this. Now, if it is available, I think most of you would like to use it as per the evidences, both in adult pediatric trauma patients and in civilian setting also. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was a very holistic talk, if I may say. Thank you. Any questions at all, or shall we take them in the end? Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. If anyone in the audience has any form of backache, headache, heartache, any of those things, please do not leave this hall. The next talk is on newer analgesic drugs by Dr. Rahul Balasubramanian.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I thank VASM team as well as EPAT team for giving me this opportunity to talk on the topic new analgesic drugs. So overview of this discussion would be briefly described regarding the pain pathway, the changing landscape in pain management, mainly the CERTA strategy, evolving analgesic and pain ladder. Brief description about traditional analgesics. Characteristics of new generation analgesic, rather analgesia, and few examples of new analgesics. So you all know pain is the root cause of main presentation, almost 75 to 80% of all complaints according to the present prevalence across the globe. So what are the challenges? Because delayed pain management is a routine in most of the busy ER. And another one is oligoanalgesia. So what do you think? The reason for oligoanalgesia is because of the fear of the side effects or the adverse effects because of the routinely used analgesics. And our aim is not to get a zero pain, but to have a practically reasonably good pain relief on reassessment, a reduction of at least 40% of pain score. And in the background of opioid epidemic in all the developing country, even in developed countries, we have wide use of opioids, which leads to a scenario called opioid overuse or opioid epidemic and its side effects. So in short, we need to have a balanced analgesia. You all know this, the pain physiology, the pain pathway, which is by peripheral nervous system as well as central nervous system. Any nociceptive stimuli from periphery goes through the myelinated as well as unmyelinated fibers, reaches the dorsal column of spinal cord, and then to the brain and the higher centers. So as in the diagram, there are different level of analgesics which can help decrease the pain. That can be both pharmacological as well as non-pharmacological. So my talk would be not only new analgesic drugs, rather analgesia. So it need not be always drugs which can decrease the pain. It can be some other non-pharmacological techniques too. So to review the pain ladder. So the conventional pain ladder, we have three steps to start with: mild, then moderate, and severe pain. Usually, we have the conventional drugs. To begin with, the most safest one is acetaminophen, paracetamol, or maybe NSAIDs. Then we move on to weak opioids and strong opioids. So what WHO has come up with is a new addition. In each step, it can be an integrative medicine therapy. And while you leap from step 2 to step 4, we have an additional one, that is minimal invasive intervention. So that can include which we all know now, even after the advent of the ultrasound and EC availability of ultrasound, regional nerve blocks as well as plain blocks are being used, which can be used in order to get a balanced analgesia so that we can reduce the adverse effects of analgesics being used. So what is the armamentarium? We told that the integrative medicine therapy, which we can include in each and every steps of pain ladder, can be a non-pharmacological, which include physical, like physiotherapy, osteopathic manipulation, mechanical support, or active mobilization. Direct like heat or ice, acupuncture, all this have got even adequate evidences to use. Transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, deep breathing, and ultrasound. Indirect like music therapy, aromatherapy, hypnosis, and even guided imagery, which can actually decrease the pain. Educational and physiological, like cognitive behavioral therapy, which we've been using for psychiatric patients, verbal suggestions, and family support. So this can be integrated to any step of the pain ladder. So it has come to an extent that a virtual reality helped reducing the pain during labor. So there is a Frey and et al. Showed in 27 unmedicated pregnant female could decrease the pain and anxiety. And in 2018, a systemic review by Scapin et al., which includes 34 studies, showed virtual reality can decrease pain while dressing changes, physical rehabilitation, and physiotherapy. Coming to this, what is CERTA approach? That is nothing new, but we all know what is written on the left-hand side of the table. That is nothing but different targets, the channel, enzymes, receptor-targeted analgesia. So rather than shooting blindly, we'll narrow down it and nail it. So that's what the CERTA approach is all about. So according from the history and the pathophysiology or etiology which you know regarding the pain presentations, you can actually target or nail the exact cause. For example, for COX and COX-2 inhibitors, we usually use ibuprofen, diclofenac, naproxen. So you can exactly nail the causative inflammatory markers. So coming to a few drugs which are considered new, need not be a newly invented one, which was used previously for some other indications, now being used as a neuroanalgesic modality. So methoxyfluorine, known as green whistle, it is a halogenated volatile anesthetic. It is non-opioid alternative to morphine that is used for acute pain relief. So usually when I talked to some of my friends in UK yesterday, so they were telling they use it frequently in pre-hospital scenario when there is some fractures. So now this is being used widely in New Zealand as well as Australia, but it is banned in United States because of the nephrotoxicity, which was there when used in higher doses. So basically it is used with a puff. You can take 3 ml of the methoxyfluorine in a charcoal contained container and take the puff one or two times to decrease the pain. And it is marketed in UK as Penthrox. So the take home would be, you can use it, but be careful how many times you use it and how you use it, and be careful about the nephrotoxicity. And there are RCTs on this, like stop trial, immediate, mediata. So it's not a new thing, but it's been using, but have to be careful while using methoxyfluorine. Next is dexmedetomidine, which again is not a new drug, but if it can be used intranasally also, which actually decrease the side effects. You all know that the side effect, being an alpha 2 agonist, it can cause bradycardia and hypotension. So if you can use it intranasally, it can actually decrease the opioid use, which we use usually for postoperative patients. So concomitant dexmedetomidine in postoperative patients is a good option, along with regional blocks as well. Next is buprenorphine, used for treatment of withdrawal. It's an opioid receptor agonist, and it is being successfully used for neuropathic pain, cancer pain, as well as postoperative pain, and even in renal colic. So 4 mg sublingual buprenorphine is an option for acute bone fractures. Next is a sub-dissociative dose of ketamine. It's a non-competitive NMDA receptor antagonist. And the main mechanism of action is decreasing the central sensitization and pain memory. And sub-dissociative doses, 0.1 to 0.4 milligram per kilogram. Again, this can be used intranasally at much lower doses. Early and rapid pain management and long-lasting analgesia is one of the advantage, and it bypasses the first-pass metabolism. So again, it helped in decreasing the side effects. Next is topical clonidine, which is classically used for refractory hypertension, and especially in chronic kidney disease. So this can be used topically for painful diabetic neuropathy, and also being used as a topical agent, again, decreases its adverse effects. So this table mainly enumerates few drugs which can be used intranasally, which we already discussed: dexmedetomidine, ketamine, fentanyl. Intranasal fentanyl is there in a lot of pediatric algorithms where you can't get an IV access. You can resort to intranasal fentanyl.
Last 2 minutes, please. Yeah.
Next is intravenous lidocaine, which has been, it can't be used routinely for a renal colic, but refractory to other drugs like diclofenac and opioids, you can consider giving intravenous lidocaine for renal colic too. Desmopressin in renal colic, again, its analgesic effect is due to its antidiuretic property. Decrease the renal pelvis pressure, and it is causing decreased pain. Next is tapentadol, a synergistic mu opioid receptor agonist and noradrenaline reuptake inhibitor. Doesn't have a active metabolite, so the risk of accumulating and producing overdose or adverse effect is less, and is metabolized by cytochrome P450 enzyme. So it has got less side effects like nausea and vomiting compared to opioid, but be careful about respiratory depression when you're using it. So alternative to morphine and oxycodone. This remimazolam is not an analgesic acid, but it is used as a sedative, but can cause analgesia when used with other drugs. So this is the certain strategy. You can map the particular receptors to the pain presentation, and you can choose which drugs to be given to the patient. It's not a complete comprehensive list, but you need to have the assessment of the patient at the same time to look for any contraindication. So what is the challenges when you talk about a new drug or a new therapy? It is always the cost, the accessibility, as well as the potential side effects. So being said that, these are the challenges. We should work on it, and the future prospect. So we already discussed the pain pathway. The sensitization occurs in the dorsal horn of spinal cord and the higher centers of the brain. So the future research or future analgesics which are being developed or are in pipeline is being addressed regarding the central sensitization and long-term potentiation. So take-home point should be limited newer analgesics are introduced recently. So older drugs used for other indications are being used for analgesia. Better we go for a channel enzyme receptor targeted analgesia rather than shooting blind, nailing it down. And there are non-pharmacological options. And finally, reduce doses, thereby optimizing safety and efficacy of analgesic regime. So our aim should not be a zero pain, but a balanced analgesia. So these are the references. Thank you. I'd be happy to take any questions.
Do we have any questions? Is anyone in any kind of pain? Okay, it's good to know. Superb. Thank you. Thank you. The next speaker is the last speaker and is talking about a topic that gives headache to patients and also gives headaches to emergency physicians, because we are seldom good at picking it up. Ladies and gentlemen, last speaker for this session, Dr. Soumya Nair, management of acute glaucoma.
Thank you, Dr. Muthasa, and thank you, Dr. Rahul. Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible? Yeah. Okay. So I would like to thank World Academic Congress of Emergency Medicine for giving me this opportunity. It's an honor and privilege to be on this stage. My topic for today, I'll just quickly introduce myself. I'm Dr. Saumya, Assistant Professor of Ophthalmology, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal Academy of Medical Sciences, Higher Education, Manipal, India. Slide change. Yeah, good. So, the topic of interest today is emergency management of acute glaucoma. Let me start with a clinical scenario. A 60-year-old female presented to the ED with complaints of acute onset diminution of vision in the right eye, which is painful, and was associated with severe headache and recurrent bouts of vomiting. She had other associated symptoms like redness, photophobia, and lacrimation. So what are the possible differentials you can think of? The first possible and the most important differential in this situation will be primary angle closure glaucoma. But you have to keep in mind other causes of acute glaucoma like traumatic, inflammatory glaucoma, lens-induced glaucoma, and drug-induced glaucoma. So what is the importance of primary angle closure? Primary angle closure glaucoma is a sight-threatening condition. As an acute care physician, saving the sight is one of your priorities, isn't it? And acute angle closure glaucoma is a great mimic too. It can mimic many of the emergencies that come into your ED, like neurosurgical emergencies, gastrointestinal emergencies, and tox emergencies. So how can you evaluate such a patient when he or she comes into the ED? So we can start with simple bedside evaluation of anterior segment, anterior chamber depth evaluation, and digital tonometry or applanation tonometry if there is a slit lamp in the ED. The anterior chamber depth evaluation can be done using a simple torchlight. Ask the patient to look straight, shine the light from the temporal side of the patient and look at the anterior chamber. Two things you have to look for. Is the anterior chamber well illuminated? And second, is the nasal iris of the patient seen properly? If the nasal iris is not seen properly and the nasal anterior chamber is in shadow, that indicates that the patient is having a shallow anterior chamber, just like the second picture there. Now, how can you assess the intraocular pressure bedside in the ED? A simple method called digital tonometry will help you. With the index finger, press on the upper lid on the eyeball of the patient, ask the patient to look down and feel the pulsation on the other index finger. And if the pulsations are not felt and the eye appear rock hard, that means the intraocular pressure is very high. Now, is there a role for point of care ultrasound in case of acute angle closure glaucoma? Yes, there is. Why? Because often in cases of acute angle closure attacks, the patient will be having a cloudy cornea due to corneal edema. This will impair the visualization of the anterior chamber and the depth assessment. In such cases, we can rely on focus. So, we can assess the anterior chamber depth, the anterior chamber structures. Even we can look into other causes of acute glaucoma like phacolysis, phacomorphic, subluxation, high femur, etc. Now, while doing focus of the eye, we have to use a linear probe, a high frequency linear probe, and it has to be kept transversely over the closed eyelid of the patient after applying a lubricant. And the pointer should be towards the temporal side of the patient. And we can see the whole globe, then the cornea, The anechoic area beneath the cornea is the anterior chamber, and then the anechoic area beneath the anterior chamber, this is the anterior chamber, and this is the lens, which is the anechoic area beneath the anterior chamber. And the line between these two anechoic area is the iris. And the large anechoic area beneath the lens area is the vitreous cavity. Now, coming to anterior chamber depth assessment, in the first image you can see that the anterior chamber is very deep and the angles are wide open. While in the second picture, the anterior chamber seems shallow and the angle seems narrower. Now, this image, the first image, shows the pupillary block. The iris is opposed to the lens at the pupil, and there is an iris bombe which is causing complete closure of the angle. The second image, you can see an anechoic lens, and above the anechoic lens in the anterior chamber, there are hyperechoic areas which is suggestive of a high femur. We can also evaluate lens changes using POCUS. In the first picture, as you can see, the lens appears hyperechoic and bulging forwards, which is pushing the iris lens, which is pushing the iris diaphragm forwards, shallowing the anterior chamber. This is suggestive of a phacomorphic glaucoma. While in the second image, I hope you can make out that the lens in one area is pushing upwards or subluxated anteriorly, and it is pushing the iris in that area only, causing a shallowing in that area, shallowing of the anterior chamber in that area. Now, coming to the treatment of acute angle closure glaucoma in the emergency department, what can we do? So, the first and foremost priority is to bring down the intraocular pressure immediately. As long as the IOP remains high, the more damage to the retinal nerve fiber layers happen and irreversible visual damage will occur. So we have to prevent that. The drug of choice is always hyperosmotic agent mannitol. We can give 20% mannitol 100 ml IV over 30 minutes. Also add on IV anti-emetic medication and stabilize the patient. Once the patient is stabilized, we can switch to oral anti-glaucoma medication such as acetazolamide, oral hyperosmotic such as sorbitrate or glycerol. When the patient is in the ED, avoid prone positioning because it will exacerbate the angle closure. Also, if there is a traumatic patient with high femur, advise head and proper positioning. Avoid midriatic cycloplegic medication, which will also worsen the angle closure. And in certain cases, we have to have a high index of suspicion for drug-induced angle closure as well. So my take-home message from this session would be, if a patient walks into your ED with headache, take a second to look into the eye of the patient. Clinically evaluate the patient in the ED and judicious use of POCUS if there is a suspicion of angle closure glaucoma. And immediate reduction of intraocular pressure should be done to prevent irreversible damage to the vision of the patient. So, say this lady walks into your ED. I hope you will keep these points in mind and you will be able to pick up the angle closure attack and manage to bring down the IOP at the earliest, so that the patient won't have a scotoma but will have a clear, good vision and a good quality of life in the future. I'll be happy to take questions. Thank you.
I think that was an eye-opening talk. Does anyone have any questions?
Yes.
I see some redness of eye in the audience. Where is that? Sorry, there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, the digital tonometry. Yeah, it's a very simple test. ask the patient to look down, use the palp of your two index fingers, okay?
Yes.
Place the fingers above the tarsal plate, at the edge of the tarsal plate. Press with one finger so that you can feel the pulsation on the other finger. You can feel it on your eyes itself, can't you? So that is indicative of a normal intraocular pressure. Normal. If it is very high, the eye will appear rock hard and you won't be able to do these pulsations. Okay? Is that clear?
Yeah.
Thank you.
After this talk, you can meet her. She'll do a free examination for you.
I'll be happy to. Yeah. Any more questions? Thank you.
There's one more, sorry. There's one more from...
Thank you. I have a question,
yes.
Actually. The setup in your hospital, is it based on ophthalmology present in the ED or emergency physician providing the care for acute glaucoma?
Acute glaucoma, both actually. When the patient walks in, emergency physician can start the IV monitor. But of course, ophthalmology team will be the ophthalmology team will be notified, and they will be taking over the patient at the earliest. Yes.
In house or home?
Yes, sir.
The ophthalmologist will be in house in the ED, or he will be called to come. So time is a factor here.
Yes, yes.
So what is actually the time factors that will require for ophthalmologists to be in-house to provide the care for this patient?
Yeah, so it will take at least 10 minutes for the ophthalmologist on duty to come, but we can save that time also if we are trained to look into the eye and understand that this is an angle closure attack. Then no need to wait for the ophthalmologist to reach. We can, that much amount of time can cause that much amount of damage to the retinal nerve fiber layer. So that can be prevented. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Does anyone have any questions for the first two speakers? We rushed them because of keeping interest of time in mind. Any questions for emergency transfusion in pregnant trauma patients? Dr. Indulata is still here. In pregnant trauma patients, emergency transfusions. Any questions on whole blood transfusion?
Yes.
Question on whole blood transfusion. So, Dr. Sandeep Sahu is here.
Yeah, if it's okay, Dr. Sandeep, I have a question regarding actually your protocol. You said in your hospital you do have whole blood transfusion. So, what is the setup? And how this impacts on massive transfusion protocols?
It's around 18 years back in India when I was doing residency. At my hospital that time, we don't have the component therapy. So we are using the whole blood for gunshot and all the laparotomies. But nowadays, in other emergency, definitely emergency medicine, we have component therapy nowadays. But I am especially being my primary specialty in anesthesia, and I am seeing day and night massive blood transfusion and severe hemorrhagic shock in the OR and ICU. And anyhow, I am thankful to my transfusion medicine department. We have to take component, but we have to do massive transfusions. And after all that thing, the only problem that I have, that patient need go in overload. So, and it's again rethinking with the evidences, because I have given task to what is the recent trends. So recent trend is coming back, and even in the wars, that is Afghanistan and Iran war, and even the things are going in disaster worldwide, the blood bank is not available, Dr. Althani, everywhere. And I think if we got the opportunity to have this whole blood, I would like to use, because I have used this during my residency days. So I have that not hesitancy, and you can say the new thing to use, whether it will work and will not work. So sorry, but nowadays in my hospital we are not having whole blood. But definitely I would like to have, especially it's good for severe polytrauma and hemorrhagic shock. Thank you, Dr. Althani. So what's your say, sir? Because you are a trauma surgeon, I know, and you work in ED, and we have seen your hospital. So what's your thought? I would like to add on this.
We've got about 1.5 minutes, so it's not bad.
Thank you. Regarding actually whole blood, the resistance comes usually from the blood bank and hematology. And in our setting, we managed to have whole blood, but that actually has two sides to it. One, you have to have availability of point of care. So in a trauma setting, we have point of care for all actually the point of care requires. So we have TAG, Rotem, INR within the trauma recess in our setting. We have a fridge also, which we have one shipment of massive transfusion plus whole blood sitting in the fridge in the recess. In the OR, we have also a fridge, which is connected to the blood bank, and we have this whole setup. The issue is the algorithm that required to run this protocols. And we are actually cautious in these patients because they have, you know, to be taken in consideration their reaction in the future and so on. But we currently have it, and we are discussing this on a regular basis with also a pre-hospital setting possible to have whole blood for this patient. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, just like many commercial flights, we have landed our session 8 minutes before time. So I'd like Dr. Beshit, if he's got anything to say in conclusion. Okay, I think the conclusion is this is concluded. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Microphone is on here, please.
Thank you very, very much indeed for your kind invitation again to this World Congress, and many thanks for these very kind words that certainly please me and honor me very much. I like to speak about one of my favorite topics, sepsis, a terrible problem. And you know that we define it, we have always defined it as a bad infection, as a life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to an infection. That's what it is. For a scientific publication, one could use a score to determine the severity of organ dysfunction. But for our everyday practice, we don't need any score. And that's the same in children. So if you look at the pyramid of severity, starting from colonization, an infection will be characterized by some host response, usually fever, an abnormal white blood cell count. When it is sepsis, there is more. There is organ dysfunction. And if there is septic shock, there is an alteration in tissue perfusion and an increase in blood lactate levels, typically above 2 milliequivalents per liter. So sometimes we identify sepsis in a patient having an infection complicated by organ dysfunction.
But we must keep in mind, and this is very true in the emergency department, that sometimes patients come with some degree of organ dysfunction, and it's not so clear why they have it. It may be sepsis. There may be a severe infection. And when we speak about organ dysfunction, we need to consider six organs: circulatory, respiratory, renal, neurological, hepatic, hematological. And these are the six items included in the SOFA score to evaluate organ dysfunction. But I'll focus on management this afternoon, and I will look at the three components: infection control, hemodynamic stabilization, and modulation of the host response. So, if you think that antibiotics work, then we should start antibiotic therapy without delay. And we should give the right antibiotic, right? That is particularly important in severe cases, that is, in septic shock. So the timing is an issue. We should not waste time when the situation is severe. So if I go back to my pyramid, it's particularly true in septic shock, when there is an alteration in tissue perfusion. And we know that sometimes we waste a little bit of time in the administration of antibiotic therapy. This is a nice recent study emphasizing at the bottom of the slide that this is particularly true in patients with septic shock. Now, hopefully, when there are signs of infection, the antibiotic administration is usually relatively rapid. So you can see when there is hypotension or when there is fever. But still, sometimes we waste time. Sometimes in the administration of antibiotics, we order the antibiotics, but the nurse is very busy with other things, and the antibiotic administration is delayed. So it's not only in the hands of doctors, it is in the hands of the team. Some people may say that we sometimes overuse the antibiotics. In the United States in particular, where there may be some medical legal aspects, give antibiotics to all patients with fever right away. That could facilitate the development of resistant organisms. So today we look at this like this, as disease severity versus degree of certainty. So if we are not sure about septic shock, but if it's septic shock, the severity is there, we should not hesitate too much before giving antibiotics. But if it's not too bad, we may have time for additional tests if it's not septic shock. Remember these important studies showing that sometimes we admit patients in the intensive care unit for likely sepsis, but actually this is doubtful at the end. When we have all the elements, we may think, after all, it was not septic shock. Or here in an emergency department in Boston, they found the same thing. Sometimes we think it's septic shock, but it's not. It may be cardiogenic pulmonary edema. It may be a drug effect. It may be some malignancy. So sometimes we give antibiotics for some patients who may not need them. We must accept it. But the choice is important too. I like this paper published recently where they showed that if you don't give the right antibiotic, prognosis is worse than if you give the right antibiotics. Okay. But this is very interesting. If you give wide spectrum antibiotics to patients who do not need it, the outcome may be worse. Perhaps because there is a selection of resistant organisms. So the message is, too narrow spectrum may be harmful, but too wide spectrum may also be harmful for the patient. And we should never forget that the antibiotic administration can be reassessed later. So give antibiotics as soon as possible. The more severe the presentation, the more urgent the antibiotic administration. And antibiotic therapy should cover all likely pathogens, not less, but not more. And of course, source control is very important. And here also, we need to motivate the team, the nurses, the surgeons, if there is a need for laparotomy, for instance, the radiologists before that, the anesthesiologist, a team effort. But let's move to the hemodynamic management. My mentor, my teacher, was Dr. Weil in Los Angeles. And Dr. Weil was saying every patient is a VIP. Ventilate, infuse, pump. Ventilate, well, we have good ways to use non-invasive mechanical ventilation today. But in shock, we should not wait too long before endotracheal intubation if required. If we wait for too long, there may be respiratory arrest. So, what are the things to look at? With my colleagues at the Surviving Sepsis Campaign Guidelines, I said we need to give recommendations to the doctor about when to intubate the trachea. And they said, oh, Jean-Louis, there is no randomized controlled trial on this. I know. But we need to give some guidance. So, would it be the degree of hypoxemia, the neurological status, sometimes the PCO2, the hemodynamic status, the muscle function? Are there plans for major surgery? It could be a combination of those. We need to help the doctors. So, my recommendation. Actually, it's not mine. I found it on the internet. It is to ask the patient to pronounce metoprolol. If the patient cannot pronounce metoprolol, it's the right time to put the tube in the trachea. Infuse. Every patient with sepsis will need fluids. Not too much, but not too little. Not too little. And we cannot go by formula. Because a patient with pneumonia may require less fluid than a patient with peritonitis. There may be a little bit of vasodilation or much vasodilation. There may be more capillary leak with unavoidable edema formation. And we may need to bring cardiac output to a supranormal level to bring enough oxygen to the cells. So some years ago, a couple of years ago, people were discussing restricted, liberal, fluid administration. This is over because these trials, randomizing patients for more or less fluids, showed no difference in outcome because some patients may benefit from one strategy, but some others may be harmed, and vice versa in the other group. Look at this recent paper, published this year in the New England Journal of Medicine, comparing more fluids with less fluids but more vasopressors. Well, if anything, the patients who were in a restrictive fluid therapy were worse than the others. They were more likely to need a stay in the intensive care unit. Clearly, fluid restriction is dangerous. There will be some edema formation. We don't like it, I agree. But that's the price to pay to have a sufficient cardiac output. We may need vasopressors, I will go to that in just a moment. But vasoconstriction is really to avoid. So we need to navigate between the two. We all know that. Maybe artificial intelligence will help us in the future to decide whether we should give more fluids or more vasopressors. But to stay with simple things, an edematous patient may be hypovolemic. Sometimes there is a doctor coming and say, oh, there is some edema here. Oh, stop giving fluid. That doesn't make sense. No. We don't know. Because in sepsis, there is always some edema formation. So let's be careful about the word fluid overload. Because sometimes we say the patient is in fluid overload when there is edema. But edema does not exclude hypovolemia, especially if there is hypoalbuminemia, which is associated. So let's be careful. Likewise, the fluid balance doesn't help very much. The patient may still need fluids even when the fluid balance is positive. So we all agree now that we need individualized therapy. Initially, in the salvage phase, when the patient arrives in the emergency department, we could just pour fluids initially, and we try to bring a monitoring system at the same time. You cannot do without a monitoring system. The studies in Zambia or in countries where they couldn't get any monitoring system failed. But hopefully today, we have echocardiography that could help, at least initially. We don't need to be experts in echocardiography. In every single emergency department, there must be an echography machine available, not only for a septic shock, but also for trauma, for heart failure, for other problems. So that helps us to go into the optimization phase, where any single variable taken alone will never tell us if the patient needs fluids or not. We actually need to combine variables. We need a dynamic approach. In the operating room, when the patient is anesthetized, we could look at the effects of mechanical ventilation on the blood pressure tracing, on the pulse pressure variation over time. That would indicate that the patient is still responding to fluids. But in the emergency department, no, because we want to avoid sedative agents in shock. Sedative agents today are better avoided because they can decrease vascular tone, decrease the myocardial contractility, increase the risk of delirium, and they induce long-term weaknesses. So today we try the ECASH concept. We try to explain to the patient what's going on when we can. Of course, we control pain with analgesia, but the patient may not need sedation. And of course, the basis for our evaluation of the response to fluid remains the fluid challenge, where we look at an improvement in tissue perfusion and the risk of edema formation. This is based on the Frank-Starling relationship. Every patient is represented by one of these dots and is on one of these lines. So we need to give a bit of fluids and see if cardiac output increases or not. And if we want to assess the risk, we want to have a central venous pressure measurement. Oh, that's invasive! I know, but the central venous catheter can also help to have access to the central venous oxygen saturation, SVO2. It can also help to give fluids quickly. It can also help to give vasopressors safely. Oh, vasopressors can be given by an intravenous peripheral line. Yeah. But one single complication would be terrible. So, the fluid challenge is not the fluid loading, right? It is a technique in which we give a bit of fluids and we assess the patient's response. Sometimes people do it over a too long period of time. I'll try to give fluid for half an hour. That's much too long, because so many things could happen in half an hour. And in the emergency department, the patient may have to go to the X-ray for a CT scan, and we lose that information. So it's 5-10 minutes. In the operating room, it would be 1 minute, because so many things happen in the operating room. But if we return to the emergency department, the studies have shown that giving about 200, 250 cc's in 5-10 minutes is sufficient. So give 200 cc's in 5-10 minutes. If the patient seems to respond, seems to benefit, you repeat it. And during these 5-10 minutes, if you want to assess the patient's response, you should not do anything. Don't touch the patient for 5-10 minutes. What shall we check? Heart rate? Well, maybe, but it's not perfect. The blood pressure? Not really, because the patients in septic shock may respond to fluids by an increase in cardiac output, and yet the blood pressure may not increase much because there is decreased vascular tone. We showed it many years ago. So optimally, we should actually assess cardiac output and see if cardiac output increases with fluids or not. We could use the technique we like. We just reviewed it for critical care medicine, if you like to look at the various systems available. But again, if you are good in echo, you could just use the velocity time integral to reflect cardiac output, stroke volume, and thus cardiac output. Today, it can even be done automatically. There are some softwares available now that can measure it for you. So that's the fluid challenge technique. You can go to that publication if you want to see the graph. It's quite easy, but we need to pay attention to some simple elements. And the most important one is that if the patient does not benefit, we stop giving fluids. The fluid challenge does not encourage to